every second we are achieving godhood. Like they say, we are actually gods with anuses, Ernest Becker says. So the second part of it is the technological advancement. Now, obviously, when people say that we are becoming gods, we need to have scientific proof of that, right? So let's look at the general trends, that what is the mass use. The one important point here is that we no longer make discoveries. The past century until now, ever since mankind originated, we have been discovering things. But now we are not discovering things, we are inventing things, we are making things. So if you, this is a logarithmic plot. So all of you must be knowing that if in a logarithmic plot the scale, the graph is linear, that means on a normal scale that would be an exponential graph, right? So this rate of growth is exponential, and when you come to this part, on a logarithmic plot, if it is exponential, then it's the exponential of exponential. So you see, in this rate, telephone, radio, television, all of them are linear on a logarithmic plot, but that means in the real scale they were exponential. And when you come to the web, the mobile phone, as you must all have experienced, it's exponential on the logarithmic scale. So on a normal scale, it's the exponential of exponential. That is, the rate of increase is itself increasing. So that's how we are progressing. Let's look at the size of the DRAMs. Okay, we are talking about technology. Again, on a logarithmic plot, it's continuously decreasing. We are at this stage right now where the size has reduced down to, say, 10 nanometers. And if the trend continues, can you imagine the scale at which we are going? Where are we leading? Right now, technology is outside us. If we keep continuing at the same scale, technology will be inside us. The transistor manufacturing, the cost. Obviously, cost is a very important factor, right? All of these show that how the cost is, again on a logarithmic plot, decreasing. That means it's exponentially decreasing. Now, our mind is counterintuitive to exponential thinking. When we think of 30 steps, say 1, 2, 3, 4, at the end of 30, that is linearly, we'll be 30 steps far, right? Our mind can only think linearly. But when you think of exponentially, say 30 times exponential, that would be a billion. Our mind is counterintuitive to thinking in a linear way only. We cannot think about exponential. I take 30 steps, I'll be only 30 steps far in a linear way. But if I do the same exponentially, I'll be a billion steps away. That's how fast, and that's the rate at which our technology is moving. Then the transistors, which are there on the microprocessor. Again, on a logarithmic plot, it's increasing steadily. So you can imagine. We all have studied Moore's law, right? That every size months. Decreases, the number of transistors increases, and all of that. This, in general, is the doubling or halving time. Suppose the dynamic, say the size, it takes 5.4 years at the current rate to actually halve the size of the dynamic RAM. The microprocessor clock speed, it takes 3 years to exactly double it. So if we have supercomputers right now working at teraflops, 3 years down the line, that will be double of what we have right now. That's the pace at which we are going. So the computing power is on the rise. Is that, like, everyone agrees with that, with the trend I have shown, you all agree, right? The rate of change is itself increasing so much. So the computing power is on the rise, and that's because of the telescopic nature of the technological evolution. Now see, throughout the history of mankind, there have been revolutions and evolutions. Let's say mankind evolved. It took 1 million years as we know it. Then came the agricultural revolution. Mankind learned agriculture. It took them 10,000 years. And after that, the world transformed. Then came the industrial revolution. It took 500 years. The world transformed. Then came the IT revolution. It took 100 years. The world transformed. You see the telescopic rate at which it is converging from 1 million years to 10,000 years to 500 years to 100 years. Right now, whatever evolution or revolution is going to come, that's going to be in less than 100 years. And if the rate continues, maybe 10 years, and then again down the line, 1 year, then again down the line, 1 day. Imagine you sleep today and wake up tomorrow and the world's transformed. That's what singularity is, that the technological evolution will achieve such a velocity that human beings in their own form right now will find it hard to cope up with it. Can you imagine? You sleep today, you wake up tomorrow, teleportation is possible. You sleep again, wake up tomorrow, the world's transformed. That's the rate at which we are going. So we've spoken about a linear and exponential, that how our brains can only think. Now the problem is, this has been around the corner, but not a lot of people have realized, because I'll come to the graph later, I'll talk about that. Now if you project the same computational performance trends throughout the next century, we can see that supercomputers will match the human brain capacity at the end of the decade. Here, this graph here shows, this is the level of manual calculation, this is the level of a bacteria, this is the level of a worm, spider, lizard, mouse, monkey and human being. And this is the gear, and this is the particular computer which has that that processing power. So you see, this is the trend right now. And if you continue projecting the same trend, at the end of 2020 or 30, we would have achieved the same computing power as that of a human brain, following the trends. Now, I'm sure you must not be satisfied that. Do you doubt if will it really be possible? 3 months ago, the world's fourth fastest supercomputer in China took 40 minutes to model 1 second of the entire brain activity. The fourth fastest supercomputer in the world right now took 40 minutes to model the 1 second of the entire human brain activity. Now, right now, I know it's not something, but like I said, if you extend the same trend forward, if the speeds increase at the same trend that we saw, 20 years down the line, it will come to 20 minutes. 20 years more down the line, it will come to 10 minutes. And then there will come a time when human brain and supercomputers will actually match pace to pace. So what then is singularity? Singularity is defined when the pace of technological change will be so rapid and the impact will be so deep that human life will be irreversibly transformed. Like I said, right? After agriculture, our life was completely transformed. After Industrial Revolution, our life was transformed. So any paradigm shift which transforms human life is called a paradigm, is called a technological, is called an evolution or a revolution. But then singularity is that point where it happens extremely rapidly. So you see, so far, this is the linear scale and this is the exponential scale. So just so that you get a context of it. Right now, we are at this point. Historians or people who forecast based on the past, so far the trend has only been linear. If you look at only this portion, it's linear. It's pretty much linear, Right now, we are at this stage. What they don't realize is that we are on an exponential scale. So only after the knee of the curve, the things go really upscale. Do you see, till this part, all of this is almost equal. This is linear. But after the knee of the curve, we human beings are at the knee of the curve right now on a technological basis. So once we cross that, it actually booms infinitely. You see that? So that's why people have not been able to realize that in the past. So on a mathematical perspective, say 1 by x, and as x approaches to 0, y approaches to infinity, That exactly is what singularity is, and that is the phase in which human beings are right now, co-evolving a technology. So now I'll talk about the epochs of singularity. That there's a very famous writer, Ray Kurzweil. He has this famous concept called the epochs of singularity. He's defined 6 epochs from the very beginning of time, which lead to singularity. Epoch 1, physics and chemistry. That is when matter came into existence. Atoms and all these things. What happened was, information needs a place to be stored. So in Epoch 1, at the very beginning of time, information was stored inside matter. Then came biology, carbon atoms came together, life was formed, DNA was formed, DNA holded information. That was Epoch 2. Epoch 3 is brains. Now our brains hold information. You see the progress. First elements were holding information, then life was holding information, then life developed intelligence and brains were holding information. Epoch 4 is technology. The brains which could think is making technology. Epoch 5 would be the merger of human technology and intelligence. Now, we have whatever we do, whatever we create is through our brains, right? So if our brains are at a level where it can create new things, if supercomputers really achieve that level, don't you think they too will be able to make things? That will be the coexistence of human technology, of technology and human intelligence. And Epoch 6 is when the universe actually wakes up, because then I'll talk about that in future. So there's another video.
All right, so let's talk about the 6 epochs. Ray Kurzweil talks about the 6 epochs of evolution as leading us inexorably towards a technological singularity, a crescendo, an orgasm of cosmic proportion. He talks about Epoch 1, physics and chemistry, information stored in atomic structures. We move on then to Epoch 2, biology, information stored in DNA. We then get to extension of our cognition, outsourcing to our technological tools the creation of the iMind, the symbiosis between man and machine that turns us into something far greater, which eventually gets us to Epoch 6, the complete flourishing of nanotechnology and biotechnology. We impregnate the universe with intelligence. We merge with all the matter in the universe, and the universe essentially wakes up. Tell me if that is not intoxicating idea, the kind of idea that inspired Alan Harrington to say, in my mind, having created the gods, we can turn into them.
So you heard him, having creating the gods, we are turning into them. So you see the pattern, it's all patterns, it's not something that someone is making up. This is how the trend has been, that information was stored into physical matter and then into life and then into brains, and then those brains are creating technology, and then the coexistence of that brain and that technology. This is how the trend has been so far. So like we discussed, Epoch 1 is physics and chemistry, Epoch 2 is biology and DNA, Epoch 3 is the brains, when our brains would hold all the information, and right now human beings are in the stage of Epoch 5, that is technology. And then the merger of human technology and human intelligence, and then comes when the universe awakens. So the events that lead to there, let's create a storyline out of it. The first, technical innovation, like I showed you, it is doubling every decade. You saw the trend. The power of IT is doubling every year, and the exponential growth is itself facing an exponential growth, like we saw initially. Then computers will pass the Turing test. I don't know how many of you have heard of the Turing test, or if you're aware of the Turing test. Turing test was basically a test created by Alan Turing, whereby he said that a machine which is possible to understand human beings and respond to them properly is at one place and a human being is at the other, and there's a human judge on the other side, and they'll be talking to both of them, and the human judge cannot differentiate between the machine and the humans, right? So that means the machines have achieved the level, that's via text messaging, not via speech, because we haven't reached the speech category yet, but via text messaging, the human judge should not be able to differentiate between the machine and the man. So computers will actually be able to pass the Turing test. They will combine the, you see, what is the special feature of human intelligence is that we can learn new things, is that we can unlearn and we can relearn. And what is the speciality of machines is that they can learn something extremely fast, and then they can do that at a repetitive rate extremely quickly, right? What is biotechnology basically is that we are, okay, that will also come later. So machines will interconnect and learn. Right now we share knowledge. I am sharing knowledge with you, you are sharing knowledge with me. That's done via language. It's a very slow process, right? It takes 12 years for a kid to be in school to come to this level. 12 years. Now imagine if machines had the power to learn and interact with each other, the speed ratio would be 3 million to 1. We interact via language. Machines interact using the data communication, right? And that is way much faster than the way humans interact right now. Machines will have access to their own source code. What is biotechnology? Let's imagine us as a program. The way we are functioning is a source code, right? Biotechnology essentially goes inside that source code and it's trying to manipulate ourselves, aren't we? That is what we are doing. You see, human beings are evolving in a way and the machines are evolving in the same way. But the only difference is that they will evolve much faster than the way we are evolving right now. So if human intelligence is at this level right now and the machines will achieve the same level of intelligence, they too will be able to do something like we are doing with biotechnology. They will be able to access their own source code and they'll be able to change stuff and able to upgrade themselves. What does biotechnology do? What is taking a medicine does? It upgrades ourselves, right? We are modifying the stuff that made us and changing it and upgrading ourselves. That is what machines will be able to do once they achieve our level of intelligence. And as we saw the trend, that too will happen soon. So human brain has a particular number of cells. We cannot increase those number of cells, right? We cannot radically change our structure, but machines will not have those limitations, right? Once it reaches into its own source code, it will know what it has to do, right? It can upgrade itself. It can add 10,000 more nodes to its structure, and then boom, the computational power has increased. We human beings cannot do that. So that is why machines will be able to augment their own capabilities without limit. And that, my friends, would just be the beginning of how human beings are actually becoming gods, because right now aeroplanes enable us to fly, okay? And that doesn't mean that technology is something different from us. It's our exoskeleton, it's our extension, it enables us to do something. The smartphone which I carry in my pocket right now, this particular thing, 30 years back, this same smartphone with the same, a machine with the same computational abilities was billions of dollars more costlier, million times more bigger. Like machines used to occupy entire buildings. A South African kid right now who has a mobile phone in his hand has the same telecommunication abilities that the president of the United States had 20 years back. You see the rate at which we are progressing, and that is what it leads to, I think, that human beings and machines will co-evolve and coexist. And that will be the beginning of a new dawn. So that's why I believe that human beings are turning into gods. Thank you.
Questions?
Yeah, sure.
So, okay, one thing adding on to the points, that every generation or every race, there was a certain thing that was going towards a peak.
Yeah.
Agriculture, industrial evolution, then tech evolution. But all of these things stop. There is a peak.
Yeah.
If they're going up, they're going to come down eventually. What do you think is a peak? And why would it come down? Why would it steep down?
All right.
And adding to it, the third thing, what would it replace to? What would be next?
So, like you said, there's a peak and it comes down. It doesn't actually come down. See, after agricultural revolution, after agriculture came in, right, we learn from it. It's not like we are not cultivating.
No, it's actually depleted. The way we are going, looking at the ratio of the population,
yes,
it's gone. We are actually paying less and less. It's something that we used to cherish more. It's something that we have taken for granted now, and we are not paying enough attention to it.
Exactly.
There are deficits.
Doesn't mean the importance of that in our lives is gone, right?
It's
we
not
still rely on food.
We do. What I'm still trying to say is we don't rely on it in the way we used to. So,
okay.
Again, the focus has shifted. We see technology as the ever answer giving.
Yeah.
No, it's not actually fully true. I mean, even we are continuously having advancements in agriculture, right?
That is
but
true, but they are based on technology now.
Yeah,
they are
based
on technology
because
now.
The amount of land we actually have for cultivation is not the same. So unless you use today's technology to increase the output of the same old farms.
Let's rephrase then the question. Okay.
Yeah.
You used to crave that time that agricultural freedom is what you need to have.
Yeah.
If I can grow my own food, I'm done.
Yes.
Now you don't crave for that anymore.
I
now you crave for tech. What will you be craving for after this? Is what
exactly. See, I agree. You're asking the question about
it's
what
a cultural shift.
Right?
It's not something that we rely on.
Yeah.
Evolution might also itself decide in eventual
time
we don't need to eat anymore.
And we could say probably we might actually venture into outer space and see if there
maybe.
Is
but
maybe.
That's again dependent
know.
On tech. But
yeah.
What is the driving factor now? Are we trying, as I said, so is the driving factor that is the human race the only intelligent race?
Oh, no,
what
that's,
else?
That's not really the thing. See, it's what's happening right now, what this focus is right now on, I agree with your point that we don't crave for it anymore, but that created a base for us. See, technology and all these evolutions are bootstrapping, I feel. Once you reach there, you build something on top of it, right?
Yes.
So you build
what
on
comes
top
after
of
tech
it.
Then?
That's what the crazy idea is, right? If you see the rate at which we are progressing, I think the way they showed in Terminator, that would be possible because machines, like I said, okay, let's talk about the future.
Thing
you're
is,
saying what
even agriculture is a technology at that.
Agreed.
Yeah.
So we don't know what we
in
we
that
know.
Case, everything that we do, what I'm trying to say is, but what's the next frontier?
We don't know. We have
we
to explain.
But I
is,
think
right?
there should be hints now. If we are at the knee, as you said,
yeah,
there should be some hints popping
see,
up.
That we cannot predict something that we don't know, right? We are at the knee after which the progress is going to be almost
there.
Deep.
Also, we are two
We've
frontiers, right?
Progress
now.
So far.
There are two frontiers. One is the frontier trying to make sure everyone else, the survival of the thing. The other frontier is making sure we progress beyond what we are thinking.
Yeah.
The ones the fortunate enough are doing the, I mean, not the fortunate enough, the people who are focused on going beyond, they're focusing on technologies of the future. Then there is another separate group which is focusing on technologies that we have at hand to make sure it serves the people that we have right now. That is another frontier which we'll be processing. How to better utilize what we currently have right now.
Let's look at this
a
little more philosophically. We were fulfilling our basic needs initially. Done. I have food, shelter and clothing.
Yeah.
What do I do next? They started looking at different people, and again, the industrial revolution came in. Now we are looking externally again.
Yeah.
As I said, we'll be looking internally again after some time.
Yeah, we will.
That's going to happen. So what I'm trying to say is now, the need or dependency on this has reduced. Eventually, dependency on tech will get reduced.
Yeah.
That's what the pattern says.
Yeah.
What would it move on to? Is something? Is are there any clues being thrown off? Is there something that we can talk about?
That's the thing.
Or it's too mystic to talk.
Let's go back to the time when agriculture was just starting to be taken granted. Industrial revolution was about to kick in. Okay, would you have imagined 100 years down the line, say, going to the moon, which was at that time probably?
In that case, I'll take miracles that we, the miracles that you talked about as the hints.
Yeah.
The miracles that, the things that looked to me as miracles is something that will be achieved next.
Yeah, that would
what,
be the science.
What is that miracle now that we crave for eventually?
Right. You could answer that. What is a miracle that you crave for?
I think a lot of miracles that we talked about is something that the technology has started to give us. And
yes.
It's,
we are naming a technology, but if you go
I'll
back
go,
to
I'll actually come on to the issue that comes with it. The technology is advancing very fast.
It is.
There might be a time when it outlasts or gets so fast that it'll outrun us.
Definitely.
There's a good chance. I'm not able to think of miracles that we can't do anymore.
The major thing right now is all the technology right now is done by man. Man, see, to say man invented computer, even the supercomputer that he was talking about that does 30 whatever,
yeah,
that is all man-made. So he's talking of a phase when the computer,
machine makes a machine.
Computer,
machine makes a machine.
No,
exactly.
No, no. I'm saying man becomes the god. Okay.
Yeah.
Now machines come up to our pace, machines become the god.
Yeah.
When machines take over.
Yeah.
At least in the god phase, I'm not talking about a forceful warrior, but machines take over. Now, whatever we can imagine as a miracle has already happened. What I'm saying is the rate at which miracles are being produced is more than the way I'm even thinking of miracles.
Yeah.
There's nothing miraculous to me anymore. So
I guess we won't realize that unless we start experiencing the we have to reach that phase where we realize nothing else miracle, then we'll require something else.
Evolving, our perception of
things are also
miracle
evolving.
Is also changing.
Thing is, human greed is insatiable. So you get something,
now,
we want something more.
Now where we are, I could look at the past and then predict what was going to happen.
Yeah.
Because see, I said the same thing. Our human brains are programmed to think in a linear way, right? When I tell you take 30 steps linearly, you can imagine, okay, 30 steps today, I'm going to be there.
Mm.
But if I tell your brain to think exponentially, if you take 30 steps, where will you be? You definitely cannot imagine what it's going to be like, right? So the trend so far has been linear. So we can predict what's going to come based on what has happened in the past. But right now, it's going to shoot upwards.
Is
like
there another possibility that it comes to a saturation point and it stops for some reason?
What would be a saturation point?
I don't know, maybe. I have, let's commit, the computation power is increasing, right?
Yeah.
From last 5 years, I'm seeing the computation power is not increasing as it should be. My laptop still works on 2.4 gigahertz.
Okay.
The earlier ones were also on 2.4 gigahertz.
Okay.
There is no use I have for tech. For very specific reasons, keep them aside,
okay.
The general population has no use for the power that they hold in the cell phone.
Okay.
The same power, actually a lesser power version of a computer was used to go to a moon, but we have a powerful computer and we use that to tweet. Right now, it's very specifically.
Yeah.
So I'm coming on to is, technology will increase. I'll not have any use for it anymore.
Okay.
I can't find a use for it. A general person cannot find a use for it. My dad can't find a use for it. Eventually, I'm saying I don't need a smartphone in my hand.
No, that's
I'm okay when
what you need. Okay, let's imagine you have a smartphone in your hand right now. You're using it for tweeting. So I said 40 years back, the same smartphone occupied buildings. Okay, it's compacted to this size. Go 40 years down the line.
No. I'm also talking about the use. The criticality of the use has decreased.
See, that's what we are limiting our view to something that we can see right now. Okay, what if I tell you your cell phone was of nano size and it can go inside your body and it can tweak with your biotechnology and do stuff? Why would you not need that? Because you don't have that right now.
Hmm.
We crave for something that we don't have right now. Technology gives you
something
promises
like
you something.
You don't have to
don't
take
have
care
have
of
right
your health.
Now.
You'll have devices
exactly.
taking care.
You'll have devices inside
the human
your
greed
body.
Is like.
See, man already exists. We're talking of nano thing, right?
Yeah, that goes, right?
You know, you can transplant it and it monitors that, but it's expensive right now.
Obviously, so it will become like the cell phone was also expensive.
Yeah, yeah.
Only precedents had back then, right? But it's becoming general use now. So that's what the thing.
This is one trend. What I'm saying is that this particular use
of
is
technology.
Coming down to a very smaller crowd day by day.
Yeah.
Less and less people are using technology
no,
in the right
not
sense.
Not really. Okay, see.
No, that's a
on
fact.
That, see, the same cell phone that you have in your pocket right now, when Apollo Lunar was, when it was sent to the moon, the computer had the same, in fact, lesser power than this, okay? IBM, in fact, predicted that the entire world, 60 years back, it said the entire world can run on 5 mainframes. Five mainframes. This room right now has more than 50 computers right now, and still that's not sufficient, right? So that time, our view was limited to that. He could not imagine the possibility that.
No, what
that
I'm saying
had.
Is, we can debate that philosophically. I'm not looking for a debate right now. I'm actually looking for if you can help me out, even think
no,
out of this
what
domain.
I'm
so coming back to the question again, I'm right now saying that there is a very specific use to technology, and that's why we dream.
No, again, not. See, I think technology enables to make something that is specific and generalize it.
Hmm.
Okay, see, that's what my example was.
Agreed.
He said if the entire country can run on 3 computers, that would mean every person would not have a computer.
No.
Right? So he felt, what is the need of having a computer for every person? But right now, every person has a computer,
yeah.
Right? So that's what the thing is. It takes something which is very specific and technology generalizes it.
What because about, let's see it in a different context. I'm
okay.
What about the whole notion? Let's not look at it technologically and trend-wise. Let's talk about humans and their emotions.
Okay.
What if we see tech intervening into our lives so much that we retaliate to it?
Are you
saying that cannot happen? One.
No, that definitely can happen.
If that happens, what will happen? The peak would still rise?
It definitely would, because that's only one side of technology you're talking about, right?
What I'm saying is,
our number one is that will take a little bit. It is not going to happen exactly tomorrow. It
yeah,
takes
no,
some time.
It's going to take
a
huge amount of time.
My
that's true.
The thing is, when man invents something, he will also to counter the problems that arise. He will also do something to.
No, I'm saying if you read science fiction, you can read. There are a lot of novels which predict about what happens with tech and blah blah blah. There are certain which talk about a dystopic world also, where tech has been banned. Dune, for example.
Yeah.
It talks about banning technology altogether. Is that not a possibility?
Yes.
They've moved back. They're talking about miracles again, which happen through people gazing into future, and all of those stargazing and everything have come back.
Yeah.
That's a demise. That's a demise of what you are predicting right now for tech.
But then again, that's only one side of technology, right?
What do you mean by tech? My question would be, what do you mean by technology?
Okay, tech is something that would give us what we crave for. It's something that we rely on.
Weed is not tech, for example. I crave
yeah,
for weed, that's not tech.
No, but you do rely on
that's
it.
Too generic. That's too generic.
To another,
that's
right?
Way too generic to answer, frankly speaking.
No, in that, everything can come.
No, it shouldn't. That's what I'm saying. It shouldn't. Tech is not everything. Tech is,
for example, you
you're saying it's generalized.
Everything you have been talking about has computational power in it.
It's
yeah.
Totally different.
It's just a fraction of tech. Even the watch in a way is technology. But
anything that makes your life simpler, if you have to put it in a very simplest way.
What I'm saying is, in this case, simplicity is overrated, frankly speaking.
Yeah.
Okay,
say that,
okay, right now, like you said, that's machine and this is tech. See, that's the problem right now. The way things are moving, even machines are able to think right now.
I'm not
so
talking about that. I'm saying I can separate that. Is weed tech? Is boozing tech? Is
no, it's not. Okay, see.
Then and do
okay.
I crave? Do I crave
okay,
for
let
it?
Can I place it this way? Tech makes your life easier, but not all the things which make your life easier is tech.
It's too generic again. That's what I'm saying. It's still too generic.
All right,
we'll go in on endless debate. So let's
okay.
deviate. What I'm trying to talk about is, technologically, I can go back to graphs, but patterns at times there are things that happen in cultures, which just break the shatter the patterns.
Yeah.
Civilizations go, boom,
yeah.
in a day. There was a pattern, they might have been taken over. Indus Valley civilization would have maybe taken over India, the whole area,
yeah,
and so. Would have been the true civilization that holds the grip of the world right now, but that didn't happen. What I'm saying is, how are we taking those things into account? Are we thinking of possibilities in which this doesn't happen? Are we all blinded that we are only thinking about this? This is the right way to go, and something happens, and no, we can't live without tech now, and tech cannot survive. Can that happen, is what I'm saying. I'm not saying that that cannot happen. What I'm saying is that the only possibility? And if you say that is the only possibility, I will refute. There's
no,
not, there's, it's never a single
race possible. Will survive if next day every electronic device will stop working from tomorrow.
Everyone would think that whenever the next day you survive or don't, it's not in our hand, frankly
yeah.
speaking. What I'm saying is, are we even looking forward to that?
All right, I give you an option right now to you know, go back to early caveman
style. I'm not saying I want to get first of all, if I'm coming as anti-technology.
No, it's not.
I'm just trying
to understand what you're.
I'm a pro. I'm not talking about shedding technology.
Yeah.
What I'm saying is,
what
is this too simpler? No, not
that.
Not even that. What I'm saying is, are we just predicting this too objectively? Okay, numbers will increase, this will happen, this will happen. Are we actually going to objectively? Are we letting go of that thing called human emotion? Are we thinking of ourselves as robots and just thinking that power will increase, this will increase, this will increase? There's a limit. There's a limit. No, I'll say, if you, if you come at me with rage, I'll take it. Come at me again, I'll take it. Again, so there's a pattern. I'll break here. I'll not follow the pattern that you had in your head.
True.
Is that true? That should be. Because in
it will
a microscopic
be true, but
sense,
we don't know that point yet, rather, as you can
shouldn't
say.
Shouldn't we also talk about predicting that rather than just connecting the
how
dots?
How will you predict
endlessly?
Something? I mean, which you don't know when it will occur. You can,
there
are contingency
things.
Every.
What I'm saying is, ki, if I always ask, ki, I can't, I will not.
Yeah,
let's talk as you have.
So
there are certain clues, as I said, there are the. In my agricultural age, looking at the moon and going at it was a miracle.
Yeah.
And that's the clue. Maybe if people start thinking of that as a clue rather than a miracle, that is where we can be. Can be. I'm not saying will be. Can be. What are those cans now? Is there a body evaluating that? Is there a body talking about that now? Because now we have refuted religion up to a good extent.
Yeah.
Up to a good extent. I'm not still saying that it should be there, not be there. Let's not go into that atheist and other debates now. But we have refuted up to a good extent. And that was our source of miracles up to a good extent. Again.
Yeah, technology is true.
Now what? Are we raising the miracles? If we raise the miracles, what do we long for? Where do we go now? And that's what happened. That is what is happening with a lot of crowd. There is no aim. People don't know where they want to go. There are no miracles to achieve.
No,
six.
I think, see,
bar camp next session monsoon. I hope you'll be talking about the same. You will give us the answer 6 months down the line.
I hope
next.
So.
Yeah.
No,
the sequel.
The sequel of.
Aren't human beings?
Hopefully, technology will also evolve in 6 months.
6 months time, and we'll. You know,
so
our,
some answers we'll get.
We'll get
hopefully.
Our answers.
No, what I think is human beings have always had this property of transcending their limitations.
So finally, there will come a starting point where it will.
It has to be saturation, boss.
Yeah,
there has
to
be.
The graph will go up and come down.
You know I'm saying?
And we come back to old.
We might not even survive the next ice age.
Yeah.
And in fact.
Because we are talking about too less a frame. Humans are too short-lived right now.
Unfortunately, none of us are going to be.
Yeah.
Unless in next 50 years there is some Amar Hazar Hone Ka Bhi technology.
Yeah,
that, that is possible.
In fact, I think we'll be part of tech then. We'll be living in these.
Definitely 500 years later, I think there will be something to keep man alive for 200
years. Yeah,
all I'm
saying
is
we might not live it over biological bodies.
Because
anymore.
Companies will want to make money out of it, so they'll keep it so high price that no one will be able to afford it.
Yeah, up to a good extent actually.
Yeah.
Lovely, actually.
Interesting.
I
session.
Wanted to attend this session. I was very happy. What do you do at sir? What the hell do you do at sir?
I'm actually an 8th semester student. I'm a college student right now.
Oh,
I'm turning it VIT.